Hey guys, and welcome to Essential Church Online. We're so glad that you joined us today. My name is Alex. I'm one of the pastors on staff. And whether you're joining us online or in one of our home church groups, we're just so glad that you're here. And we hope that you get a lot out of today's service. If today is your first day joining us here at Essential Church, we're a church that aims to remove every non-essential barrier between people and God and lead people towards a loving relationship with Jesus Christ that they can enjoy for all eternity. We're so glad that you joined us today. It's never been easier to invite someone to church, and so right now on whatever platform you're on, go ahead and hit the invite button, maybe start a watch party on Facebook, or share the link with somebody over text. Invite someone today that you know who desperately needs to know the love of Jesus. One of the things that we do every week here at Essential at the end of service is we take communion together. And so at some point, you can go ahead and gather the items to represent the bread and the cup. And so maybe that's the coffee and the toast that you're eating for breakfast. It's all right. That's totally fine. If you're in one of our church home groups, our leader, your leader, will have those available for you at the end of service. Right now, we're going to go into a time of worship. So you join us today as we worship God together.
treasures that fade never enough. Then you came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied. Oh,
us the opportunity to know you now and for the rest of eternity. It's in your mighty name we pray. Amen.
So how does somebody get to the point where they're willing to walk out on their best friend's wedding as a bridesmaid to go and help somebody else pick out a suit? Is it really just because you love emergencies? Is it just because you crave the excitement? Or is it because you seek out codependent relationships? Well, this morning, we're going to be talking about that very topic. We've been in a series called Masked, where we are seeking to unmask the hurts, habits, and hang-ups that continue to mess up in our life. And so far, we've been looking at things that have been quite obvious for most people to see. They're things that are easy to identify. If somebody has an anger issue, or a substance abuse issue, or a food addiction, or has trauma-related stress, those are things that are oftentimes pretty easy to figure out, diagnose, and see in somebody's life. However, what we're going to be looking at this morning is something that affects many more people than any of the other things we've talked about so far, but it's harder to see in yourself. It's harder to recognize the pattern in your own life. Rather, when you're doing things that a codependent person does, they look more like somebody who's just a good person, somebody who's a caring person, somebody who's a loving person, somebody who does kind things. Dare even say someone who is just a good Christian. But in reality, there's a codependency issue there. And that's what you see reflected in that movie, 2 Week Notice, where Sandra Bullock plays the part of somebody who just wants to be a good employee. She just wants to be helpful. She likes to be needed. She wants to be a needed employee. And when somebody like that, with that sort of personality or bent or desire, comes in contact with somebody who's a narcissist like Hugh Grant in that film, who his whole world revolves around himself, that's just a perfect recipe for a codependent relationship to form. Now, when I say codependency, I got to acknowledge the fact that it is a word that is so overused that it falls into the category of not having a clear, unified definition, because so many people use it for so many things to describe so many things. There's no one universal definition. So if somebody says, are you codependent, you really need to talk about or describe what it is you're talking about when you talk about codependency, because different people have different meanings for it. So when I'm talking about it here, I'm talking about a dysfunctional relational pattern rather than a mental illness. And it's a dysfunctional relational pattern that, once it's identified, you can change that pattern. You can work to stop that pattern and stop that cycle. You just have to be able to identify it and see what the root causes of it are and what it looks like. The definition I really liked for codependency is this. It's a pattern of behavior that is characterized by fear-driven motivators of compulsivity and manipulation and is caused by low self-esteem, difficulty drawing boundaries, and identity issues. Once again, codependency is a pattern of behavior, or I should say a pattern of dysfunctional behavior in a relationship that's characterized by fear-driven motivators. So in other words, somebody's doing this out of fear they're going to lose the relationship, fear that somebody else is going to get upset, fear that they'll have not be needed anymore. So there's a fear-driven motivator of either compulsivity, where they just feel like they're compelled, they have to do this, or they've been manipulated to do this. What you see in association with this is it's driven by a low self-esteem. In other words, I need to be needed. I need somebody to find a worth or a value in me, and I don't feel worthy enough or good enough, and I feel worthy and good enough because I'm able to meet this need in somebody's life. And there's always a difficulty in drawing boundaries of saying, this is what you're supposed to do, this is what I'm supposed to do. This person has a difficult time saying no. And so then, as well, what happens is this results in identity issues where they don't have an identity of themselves. They don't have a life of their own. Their life is solely wrapped up in being Caleb's mom or being Jennifer's wife or husband. How does that work? Anyways, back when this first began, it came out of the CRAA movement when they would notice this pattern of behavior. When you had an addict, there was always somebody alongside them that was an enabler in their life, that was helping them continue this destructive behavior, that was bailing them out, that was making excuses for them. And when somebody's an enabler, what they're doing is they've created a codependent relationship where they serve as sort of a functional savior for the addict, saving them from all of their mistakes and problems and responsibilities. But in turn, that addict is sort of giving them a sense of meaning and purpose in life and sort of saving them from a life of meaningless. And so you see that's where the codependency comes from. They're each depending on the other person for something, and they wouldn't be able to exist without each other because of what they're getting from each other. And so what ends up happening is The enabler, who's in a codependent relationship, will do things like make excuses for the addicts. They'll bail the addict out of jail again and again and again. They'll get them out of their consequences. They'll call the school. They'll call the employer. They'll call friends, and they'll make up reasons why it happened and try to talk their way out of it. They'll loan money again and again and again, and it's almost ridiculous even to call it a loan. I don't know why you still call it a loan. You know you're just giving them money because you know you're never going to see a dollar of that back, regardless of what they say, regardless of what their intentions are. This person is somebody who you could give $1 million to, and they would be out of that $1 million within a year's time. This is somebody who wants you to act as their personal assistant in life. They want you to make their doctor appointment for them. They want you to schedule everything in their life and keep after them and help them pack their car and make sure they have their lunch when they leave the house, even far beyond when they have the need for that in their life. They continue to want you to be their personal assistant. Further, this is somebody who, again and again and again, they always need a place to stay. They always tell you it's just for a little while. However, last time and this time, they will not obey the rules of your house, whether you know you don't want drugs in your house or loud noise in your house, whatever it is. They refuse to obey any house rules, and they want you just to accommodate. And then when that relationship falls apart, eventually they will come back around with a sob story, a need story, and you'll invite them back in, and this time will be different. And let's face it, it never is. And so you wonder, what do I do? Because deep down, you see the good in them. Deep down, you think if you can just give them sort of a helping hand, it'll be a help out, not a hand out, and this will just kind of help them get to where they need to be. And it happens again and again and again, and before long, it becomes an enabling relationship. And their enabling relationships, most of the time, end up in codependency, where you have this need to be needed by that person, where you need to be their functional savior, and you feel a great sense of worth and value and dignity in life because of what you're able to do to help, and you tell other people about this help story that you are and what you've done and all the good that you've done in this person's life. And that's where this idea of a codependency comes from. And this can happen in a lot of different kinds of relationships. Some, you know, like for instance, in the movie we saw was an example of a codependent relationship between an employee and their boss. And it can happen between two employees. Maybe you have an employee you always cover for. Maybe somebody at work, you're always doing their job. You're always making it look up or making it look good because you don't want the customer to have to suffer. And so you're always going behind them. And there's this codependent relationship that forms as a result of that. Sometimes it's parents who won't let their kids grow up, and you're still tying their shoes and fixing their lunch for them when they're in the middle school, and you're still doing things into high school that you did back when they were in elementary school, and then you're letting them continue to be a kid into their 20s and into their 30s, and it's like as if you've never let that person ever grow up and be their own person. Why? Because you have a need to be this parent. You have a need to be needed in their life, and so it can happen between parents and kids. It can happen with roommates. Maybe some of you have had some of those roommate situations. You got a roommate who won't clean up after themselves. They won't pay rent. Why don't you kick them out? I don't know, because you're just trying to help them out. It becomes a codependent relationship. A lot of close friends are like that. They're always coming to you, but they always need favors. They always need help. And it seems like there's no balance in the relationship. It's just a giver and a taker. And then, of course, the most common codependent relationships are that in marriage. And to hear more about that and get a little glimpse into what this looks like in real life, I want to share with you right now Tammy's story. She talks about her journey with codependency.
I'm Tammy, and I've been with Essential for probably close to 3 years now, and I've been attending Celebrate Recovery since they opened, since the beginning. Growing up, I was raised by a single mom. My father left when I was about 2, and I was just kind of was an attention seeker, a problem fixer, somebody who I had to fix everything. I had to make everybody happy. I was a people pleaser. As I got older, I continued the pattern of just people pleasing and putting myself on the back burner and doing everything for everybody else, no matter the cost to myself, whether it was inconvenient for me, whether it was putting myself in jeopardy. I always did for others and never myself. My husband struggles with addiction, and I continued the pattern of putting him first, being an enabler, doing everything to please him and his addiction, and putting myself and our family in jeopardy when he had a relapse a couple years ago, it kind of coincided with the opening of CR for our church. And so he signed up and he volunteered me to work in the kids ministry. And that is how I kind of came to CR. A couple months later, he relapsed again, and I found myself reaching out for help, not for myself, but how to fix him again, the fixing. In the process, I learned that I can't fix him, that I have to fix myself and work on myself and my codependency and not worry about how it affects other people, worry about myself and the kids, and I can't fix everybody. And that was really hard to learn. Something that was really hard for me was when my husband got arrested. I had to make that decision to no longer be a codependent and no longer be an enabler for him, and leave him in jail. You know, he called me wanting me to bail him out, and I couldn't. I had to put my foot down and stop being codependent. And had I not, I don't know where we would be now. I don't know that he would have ever gotten past his addictions. I don't know that he would even be alive at this point. Some of the steps I've taken to seek healing from codependency, I attend CR weekly. I did a step study, which was huge. I actually started step study when my husband was in rehab. So it was, he came home to a completely different person. I have a sponsor and accountability partners that I reach out to daily, and just really just setting boundaries is a big one. And just making sure that I'm focusing on myself when I need to. So in CR, we don't give out cure cards. Nobody is fixed. I will forever be codependent. And I have codependent urges probably on a daily basis, but it's really important and it's vital now that I can recognize those and say, oh, wait, hold on. I'm being codependent right now. I need to take a step back, evaluate the situation, and see what is really what I need to do here and what is really going to benefit me and my family and what is the right course of action. Since finding healing from codependency and starting CR and starting my journey, I've really found a new relationship with God, to be honest. I've only really knew him on a surface level before, and now, you know, I do my devotions daily, and I'm really just trying to seek after him more. And I've really learned that there is no judgment. You know, he forgives you of your sins, and if he can forgive you, then you need to forgive yourself.
The thing about codependency is it's a subtle corruption of Christian principles and values. And so often the person who becomes the enabler in the codependent relationship will say things like, I'm just trying to love them. I'm just trying to be Christ to them. I'm just trying to help them out. I mean, after all, aren't there lots of stories and parables where Christ is telling us to reach out and to help the less fortunate? Isn't that what Jesus would do for someone? And the honest answer is no, that's not exactly what Jesus would do for somebody. I think you've missed a few of the important details. Jesus made himself available to help people who are in need, but he didn't need the attention or need to be needed. Do you understand that? He was there and available to help people in their time of need, but he didn't have a need to be needed. He didn't have a need for the attention. And if somebody rejected his help, or if somebody didn't want to listen to him, or if somebody was trying to misuse or abuse his generosity, like there was a time where he fed 5,000 in John chapter 6, and then the people show up and they try to coerce him and manipulate him into feeding them for free every day. And he's not going to have any of it. And eventually they all leave. And they're like basically saying, well, we'll follow you and we'll lift you up as a Savior and Messiah if you do this for us. And he's like, sorry, that's not what I'm here for. I don't need your attention, and I don't need you to follow me to feel like I'm whole and complete and to have accomplished my mission. I am who I am. Either you accept God as I am, or you reject me, and that's okay. And that's a healthy pattern for relationships. Either somebody loves you and accepts you for who you are and as you are, or they don't. And once manipulation comes into that, you're going to be moving down towards a codependent relationship, and Jesus refused to ever get into that kind of relationship. When Jesus tells the story of the prodigal son, he talks about a father who's got a son who very clearly doesn't want to obey the house rules. He wants to live wild and crazy. He knows he can't do that there in the father's house. And so he says, I want to leave. Now, does the father chase after him? No. The father waits patiently on the front porch, longs for his son to come home. The son knows his father loves him, but the father's not chasing him out. And what happens? The son ends up there in a pig pen, eating what pigs eat. And it's only at that point. Now, in that moment, the enabler is going to go rescue. The enabler is saying, I just can't let my boy sleep with pigs. I can't do that. But in the story that Jesus tells about the way Father handles this, it says, no, he needed to get to the pig pen. And maybe somebody in your life needs to end up in the pig pen. Because it's only at that place where it says in the scriptures, he came to his senses. And then what you see right after that is he begins to take personal responsibility finally for his actions. He says, I have sinned against God and against you. It's not until somebody, we often call it hitting rock bottom. In Christian terms, I talk about, sometimes you need to pray for pigs in somebody's life, that they'll end up in the pig pen and just realize this is the mess I've made and I'm here because of what I've done. And it's only at that point that that person will be able to come to their senses, because what the enabler does, what the codependent does is they swoop in and rescue them from the consequences of their actions. They swoop in and keep them from having to eat the pig slop. But if you keep swooping in, it's at that moment of being in the pig pen and dealing with all of the consequences of your actions, and you heard that in Tammy's story, that finally the person who has the issue will come around and say, hey, I did this. I need to make a change. And unless they're willing to make a change on their own, you can't do it for them. And all the rescuing you're doing isn't actually helping them in the end. And it's so hard to know the answer to the question of, well, what then is the loving thing to do? I mean, what is the loving thing to do in this situation? And it's a situation that fortunately we have some guidance in the scripture for. If you will, turn with me over to Galatians chapter 6. In Galatians chapter 6, it's right after he talks about the fruits of the Spirit, which we talked about in our last series this past summer. And in Galatians chapter 6, he says this, carry each other's burdens, and this way you fulfill the law of Christ. There it is. Help somebody out. Carry each other's burdens. And then he goes on in verse 5 and says, for each one should carry their own load. Now, you look at that and you're like, well, see, this is what frustrates me about the Bible. There's all these contradictions. It's telling you, help somebody out, and then it says, don't help somebody out. It's saying, carry each other's burdens, and then it says, carry your own load. So which is it? Well, the carry your own burdens, let me back up. Carry one another's burdens is a word in the Greek language, which is a burden that is too heavy for one person to carry. I would say it's sort of like, you ever like move your kids to college? I don't know if y'all still do this. Like you have like a big trunk. I know in the military, you have like your backpack that you carry, but then you also have like these storage bins that you carry, these big like Pelican cases that you carry stuff in. Sometimes it takes more than one person to carry because it's too heavy for one person to carry. So that's what he's talking about. He's talking about a burden in life that's too heavy for you to carry alone, or too heavy for you to walk that road alone. This is when a global pandemic happens. Many of you have needed help. Right now you're needing help with childcare and other things that are coming up. You need help. That is an excessive burden that you're not equipped to handle on your own. So you need to reach out for help. When you've gone through an issue of tragedy, when you have issues of trauma that have come in your life, when you have a health crisis, it's okay to ask for help, and you need to ask for help because you're not meant to walk that road alone. And we are called to come alongside. That's why, as a church, we over the years, we have come alongside people who are in their time of need. We had small groups that have reached out, and people have reached out and provided meals simply because during those times to fulfill the law of Christ, to love one another, we need to help you carry your burden through that difficult time in crisis. But then he goes on and he changes the word when it says, but each should carry their own load. It's a different word. It's a word that meant the amount of cargo that a ship can safely carry. The amount of cargo that a ship can safely carry. In other words, this is the amount that one vessel can hold and can handle on their own. In other words, this ship doesn't need two ships to take this load. One ship can take it where it needs to go. And, you know, each of us have God-given responsibilities that we're supposed to be responsible for, that's a part of the load that we've been given in life. And they're age-appropriate. There's chores that children need to be doing from the earliest of age on up, clean their own room, help set the table, take out trash. There are chores or responsibilities that increase over time. And you're doing a disservice if you take that burden off of your children and you do it for them. I know you want to be helpful, and I know you want to be the mom or the dad that's there to help your child because maybe you feel you need to be needed. What can happen there is you might be creating a codependent relationship with your child because you need to be needed by them, and you're making a child who's totally dependent upon you long after they should be. I mean, are they making their own lunch yet? If they're past second, third grade, that's something they need to be helped, at least getting the ingredients out. There's schoolwork, there's housework, there's work. I don't know which one is what you're doing, but that's your work to be doing. You shouldn't be doing your kids' homework, and there's chores that you have around the house, there's chores that somebody else has around the house, there's also work you do outside of the home. You need to be responsible for that and do what it is you've been assigned. There's relational duties that we have as a husband or as a wife, as part of the family. And it's all about owning and taking responsibility for the consequences of our choices. That if I made this choice, I have to own the consequence for it. And God expects us to handle our business. Now, there was a group of people in Thessalonica that got these things confused. And they tried to manipulate and play the Jesus Christian, what would Jesus do card on somebody. And this is over in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10. 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 10, it says, when we were with you, I gave you this rule. If someone's not willing to work, they don't eat. And we hear some of you are idle and disruptive. They're not busy. They're just busybodies. And such people we command and urge in the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down and earn the food they eat. And as for you, brothers and sisters, never tire in doing what is good. Doesn't this seem to go against everything that sounds Christian? I mean, come on. These people don't have anything to eat. They're starving. It's like, yeah, they need to get a job. They need to work for that. If they are able to get a job, they need to get a job. I'm not talking about somebody who's not physically able to get a job. Like my daughter, special needs, will probably never hold a job, and that's okay. But for somebody who can hold a job, they need to get a job. And yes, it's bad and it's tragic. They're facing the consequences of their actions and their failures. But what will ever lead them to make a change? And so he says to them clearly, he says, it's not your responsibility to take on somebody else's responsibility to care for themselves. And what this comes down to, he's basically saying, is their need to provide for themselves is part of their backpack. That's not a burden for you to carry. That's a part of their backpack. To kind of give us a little bit better illustration, here at Virginia Beach, a lot of our backpacks are beach chair backpacks. And so if you're going to the beach, maybe you've had this sort of thing, especially if you have kids, you'll be all packed up. You're all ready to go. You got your beach bag, your backpack chair, and you got whatever you need for the day because there's these nice little handy pouches in the back. And somebody else in your family, though, will have packed their backpack a little bit differently. Now, in addition to having things you need, like your towel, some sunscreen, some essential church sunglasses, in addition to those sort of things in their backpack, they also decide that if they're going to spend the day at the beach, they need some other things. They need to have bocce ball. I don't know why they need to have bocce ball, but they need to have bocce ball. They need to have their swim fins so they can get around. They need to have a frisbee to play. They need some beach toys and a shovel, stuff to play around with. And so they pack all this stuff up in their beach chair. By the way, if you got one of these chairs, just so you know, you can put stuff in the backpack portion, but then if you get the right kind of chair, you can put stuff in the seat portion. So they got all this junk in their backpack, and they pick it up, and what do they say? Oh, it's too heavy. Can you carry this for me? Now, if somebody else is watching and you say back, no, you carry, you packed it, you carry, don't you sound mean in that moment? Doesn't it sound insensitive to say you carry it? Now, some of you are like, no, it doesn't. That's because you have a healthy disposition about this. For others of you, you see that if it's your child, though, you see them like, oh, Well, here, we'll swap backpacks. I'll carry yours with all the junk that you felt you needed that you're bringing on this excess burden. And here, you carry my light backpack that just has what we need. Or, worse yet, you do this. Well, here, I'll put on your backpack on this shoulder, and then I'll get my backpack on this shoulder here. Oh, okay, well, I dropped a Frisbee. Hang on, I got it. Okay. But remember, we have the trunk that we need to all, we were both going to get a side of this because we're going to the family barbecue at the beach and we were going to bring the drinks, everybody else bringing food, but our family was to bring the drinks, and so you got this big old cooler. Now notice this, the design of the cooler, it's got a handle on each end, which you pretty much can't even reach. It's designed to be carried by two people, but you see people doing this, what? They out there, and they looking like this right here, trying to get down the beach, right? So, some of y'all been there, right? Pack muling it in. I dare say you might not be a pack mule. It might be something else in that same related family. I don't know. Carrying all this junk down to the beach. Some of you right now, that was a picture of your life, wasn't it? And there's somebody else who's just hopping and skipping down to the beach, all carefree. Working, moving their way through life like they don't have a care in the world. And there's a resentment that builds up. There's a frustration that builds up. But at the same time, though, you feel needed, and you get there, and it was like, wow, look at you. Look at all the stuff you carried. And you love the accolades because you carried it all. You love the pats on the back. You know, when somebody, like, helps you carry the cooler the last 2 feet. There's something you thrive on that. That is codependency, where you're carrying somebody else's backpack. And here's the thing. Oftentimes, if you're carrying somebody else's backpack, you're not able to then help somebody who truly has a need, has a trunk that needed help carrying. You know, if you've got all that junk on there and somebody else has a big cooler to the beach, do you have a free hand? No, you don't, because you're carrying everybody else's stuff along the way. And these boundary issues often happen because the person that you're in a relationship with, they're trying to get you to carry that backpack. Because as far as they're concerned, it is your job to carry all the stuff I want at the beach. That's your job. You're in a relationship with me. You're my mom. You're my dad. You're my husband. You're my wife. You're with me. You committed to do this. And if you don't, I'm going to get mad. And so they say things like this. Well, it's your fault when I get mad and lose my temper. Well, it's your fault that everybody's upset at me for my actions. It's your fault that I had to sit in jail. I mean, you should have bailed me out. Did you listen to that in Tammy's story? That was a hard decision. It's always a hard decision. It's your fault that I'm suffering the consequence for my actions. It's your fault. You're the bad guy. You're unloving. And you're not Christian. Oh, you're some Christian, you know, acting, not even doing that. You heard that? I get that accusation all the time. Oh, and you call yourself a pastor? Yeah, I'm carrying my own load. I expect you to carry your load. When there's a burden that's too heavy for you to bury or to carry, we'll all come alongside you and help with that. But this is something you need to take care of on your own. Galatians chapter 6 goes on to say, right after this in verse 7, it says, don't be deceived. God will not be mocked. A person reaps what they sow. You will reap what you sow. In other words, what you put in the ground is what's coming up out of the ground in your life. What you're planting today is what you're going to harvest in a couple months from now. Unless the codependent person runs by the grocery store and gets you something you didn't plant. And bails you out so you don't have to reap what you sowed. I'm taking this from a married couple that are both counselors, Linda and Charlie Bloom. So the conversation the codependent person needs to have is this. Something that sounds like this. I like you and I want to spend time with you, but I also need time for other things as well. And I feel like that's a reasonable request that I'm making. I'm letting you know this is important to me, and I'm asking you to respect that and not take it as a rejection of you, because it's not. I love spending time with you. I'm not leaving you. I'm not saying I don't want to spend time with you, but I feel that we need some balance in our life, and the intensity and exclusivity of how we spend every moment of our free time together is not sustainable or healthy for either one of us. We need to both be able to develop our own friendships, hobbies, focus on our jobs, our kids, God, as well as each other. And you need to take responsibility for the things that are your responsibility. I need to take responsibility for things that are my responsibility. And then there's this other stuff that we both can share. And that's what we want. That's what I want to talk to you about today: is what's your responsibility, what's my responsibility, and what do we together need to take on together? That's a conversation many of you all need to have. And you notice even in there was sort of some built-in pieces where they're expecting the blowback and the name-calling, the accusations, and the manipulations. You got to know that's going to be a part of it if you had that conversation. In every relationship, there's a give and take. There's a healthy give and take, an ebb and a flow, where both people are making sacrifice of each other. And that's all acceptable and good. However, in the codependent enabler relationship, it becomes very lopsided, where one person is pretty much the giver and one person is the taker. One person is the one who continues to give love and show love, and the other one's a person who continues to need love and receive love. And the balance that the scriptures teach is in Ephesians 5:21, where it says, be submitted to one another, where both of you are considering each other's needs. Philippians 2:1-4 talks about how you're putting the other person's needs ahead of your own. Both of you need to be doing this. And if you're in a relationship where only one side is doing it, it's not healthy. I love the book, The Giving Tree, but that's not a healthy relationship. The Shel Silverstein book, The Giving Tree, what you have in there is you have a tree who gives and gives and gives and gives and enables everything the man wants to do throughout his life. And what does he do? He takes and takes and takes and takes until there's nothing left of the tree. That's not a healthy relationship. Is it loving of the tree? Yes and no. At the end of the day, it's not healthy. It's not what the scriptures describe. We get into these patterns of relationships because every one of us has a I'm not good enough story. Every one of us has an I'm not good enough story. Sin makes us feel unworthy of love and unuseful. Like, what could I ever do? How could I ever help somebody with the kind of person that I am? Sin will always make you feel unworthy of love and unworthy of value or usefulness in this world. Sin will strip away your identity and your value that God has placed in you and created you with. That's what sin does in our life. And because we feel unworthy, because we don't feel worthy of love, what ends up happening is that instead of receiving God's unconditional love, instead of receiving God's redemption, instead of receiving God's purpose for our life, knowing that we were created to have a loving relationship with him that we'll enjoy for all eternity, and instead of finding your meaning and significance in Jesus Christ, what will happen is you will settle for somebody who looks to you to be good enough to meet their needs, because you're good enough to bail them out, and you're good enough to provide for them what their actions and all the consequences of their life keep requiring. And you're good enough to meet that need. And what happens is you end up settling to be somebody's functional savior. And this morning, this may have hit home for some of you to really look into your life, and there's a conversations you need to have. Now, I'm not looking for you to go out and point fingers and get into a big argument this afternoon. These are some things you need to think through. Maybe before you go and confront the person you may be in a codependent relationship with, maybe you need to talk to some friends. Maybe you need to come to CR and talk to some others who, like Tammy, who've gone down the codependent path and say, is this really where I'm at? Is this really something I'm struggling with before I go further with this? If you take on someone's backpack in life, it's going to suck the life out of you. And if this message is ringing true, here's some things maybe you need to do or think about. One is you need to assess, what are you doing for someone else that they're capable of doing for themselves? What are you doing for somebody else that they're fully capable of doing for themselves? This goes for parents, coworkers, marriage, dating, whatever it might be. What are you doing that somebody else is capable of doing for themselves? Next of all, what are you neglecting in your own life because of the things you're doing for someone else? What are the things you may be neglecting in your own life because you're carrying around somebody else's backpack? Maybe you have no free time. Maybe you have no relationships. Maybe, I don't know what it is. But what is being neglected in your life? There's some people, they are so big on helping everybody else, their family gets neglected. You know, what is it that you're neglecting because you're carrying somebody else's backpack? If I talk with them about what's in my backpack, what's in your backpack, and what's in our trunk, how's that going to go over? If I talk to somebody about what's in my backpack, what's in their backpack, or what should be in mine, what should be in theirs, and what really is in the trunk, how's that conversation going to go? Thing is to have a great relationship, you have to be willing to not have it. To have a great relationship, you have to be willing to not have it. See, that's what codependency is. Codependency is where somebody says, we have music about this. I can't live without you. I can't breathe without you. You're the, you know, my whole world revolves around you. That's codependency. If you can't live without that relationship because you look to them as being your source and provider and sustainer of happiness, meaning, and significance and fulfillment, that's codependency. They're fulfilling in you what only Jesus Christ can fill in your life. And so you need to have that conversation. Both you and the other person in this process need to look to Jesus Christ to be their source of meaning, significance, and to be their ultimate Savior. Would you join with me as we close in prayer? Father, I thank you for your grace that covers all. I thank you that no matter what we've done, no matter what we've become, you continue to love us. And even though our sin makes us feel unworthy and useless, your Bible is a testimony and a testament of all of the people who've all gone before us and had those same feelings. So, Father, forgive us, Father, for looking to other people, to other things, to fill what only you can in our life. Help those who are listening this morning to identify the patterns of codependency and accept their identity in you and you alone, to be able to draw up healthy boundaries in their life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In John chapter 6, after Jesus has fed the 5,000, they come after him looking for him, and they want him to provide them with some more free bread. And he looks at him and says, I am the bread of life. And it's one of those situations, as I mentioned before, how they're trying to coax him into a codependent type of relationship where we'll make you our savior if you meet our needs. And he's unwilling to do it. Instead, what he does is he says to them, he begins to talk about communion, and he does it in a way that they think they're talking, makes it sound like it's cannibalism. And he says, unless you're willing to eat of my bread, eat of my body and drink of my flesh, you can have no part of me. And it says, from that day on, many of his disciples, many of his followers followed him no more. Many followed him no more. He was willing to walk away from the relationship knowing it would become an unhealthy relationship. And right now, maybe you're in the situation where you are looking to God to just simply be a functional savior for you. You're just looking to God to bail you out, to be associated with his name. And you don't really want to have a true relationship with Jesus Christ. You just got to know is he will not change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he'll look to you and continue to make the offering and say to you, there's nothing you've ever done that'll ever make me love you any less. You still have a use and a purpose and a meaning that you can find in me, and you'll find nowhere else. So let's deal with the sin problem right now and take this bread. Be reminded that my body was given for you on the cross to pay for your sins. And then he took the cup, which was the cup of redemption. There is still a use. There is still a purpose. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. Allow God to continue on, as we mentioned last week, the great redemption story he's working in your life. Will you come and join and share in communion with us this morning as we continue our time in worship?
When this life is overwhelmed, feel like giving up, I will cling to all you promised. It will always be enough. When the world around me crumbles and it's hard to understand, I will run to you, my shelter. I am safe within your hands. Oh, you are my help forever. I will not fear. God, you are with me. I know you're near. You'll never leave. thank you for all that you've done, all that you're continuing to do. Thank you for being such a good, good Father. We love you, we praise you, and it's in your mighty name we pray.
Thanks. I'm Chris, one of the pastors here at Essential Church. Just want to say welcome today, and hopefully you enjoyed the service. But more than that, hopefully you're not watching alone. Hopefully you're part of a community. If you're not, if you're interested in being a part of a community, part of a home church group, or just a group of people that gather together to watch together, give me an email, give me a shout, chris@essentialchurch.com. We'll try to set you up in a group or help you start a group so that you're not doing life alone. A couple of quick announcements. If you enjoy the idea of community, if you're enjoying this series, we invite you to come out this Wednesday night, September 9th at 6 o'clock for dinner, 7 o'clock for service, as we celebrate Recovery's two-year anniversary. Also, we are going to start in-person service next week, September 13th, 9:15 in the morning or 10:45. We invite you to come back. We need the extra time between the services so we can make sure we sanitize the building properly during these days. If this is your first time today, welcome. We hope you enjoyed yourself. We hope you'll come back. But if you'll let us know that your first time, we'll reach out and see if there's anything we can meet in your life or just answer some questions. We just want you to know that we're excited that you're with us these days. If you realize today this life is about nothing more than a loving relationship with Jesus Christ that you can enjoy for all eternity, we want to celebrate with you. If you'll text the word eternity to the number on your screen, we'll reach out and celebrate. If you got questions about that, go ahead and text the same word eternity to that number, and we'll try to help you with those questions. Every week we invite you to give back a portion of what God richly blesses you with from week to week so we can continue the ministry here in Virginia Beach and around the world. So if you'll find the word give on your platform and give back, God will continue to do the work right in our own community. Now as we go, may you find healing as you help others carry their burden as they carry their own load today, tomorrow, and for all eternity. Be blessed.